You have no idea the amount of ignorant mess we're about to get into right now.
Hello and welcome to a brand new episode of Black on Black Cinema. I'm your host, Jay. I'm here with my co-host, Micah.
Hey.
And special guest, Tiara.
Hello.
This is episode 134, Acrimony. Terrence is unfortunately not here. He is sick. He definitely wanted to be here. I know that for
a fact.
He
wanted to be here because he wanted to sing the praises of this film because he loved it so much.
He really
did. Being his seventh time seeing it.
He really did. I can tell you from, you know, personal experience that Terrence really loved the writing. He is such a huge Tyler Perry fan.
You said that he was watching it and was amused, right?
Yeah, he was.
Like, he was legit, no bullshit. Like, he was smiling.
He was even like, yo, I have to go back and watch that scene again because it was so good.
Yep.
And he loved the acting from Taraji. And he loved, and we definitely, you know, he definitely made a point about all the man butt that makes an appearance in this movie. So,
yo, he is going to fight all of us. In a weird battle royale for his own reputation. So this episode 134, this is about, well, one, before I even get started, this is our second Tyler Perry movie that we're doing in one calendar year. So we broke our rule. You're welcome. Never ask us to do more than one of these in the same year ever again. So I'll start with you, Micah. None of us had seen this movie ahead of time,
no,
right?
Mm-mm.
Except for Terrence, who had seen it six times, I believe. Micah, your thoughts on this?
This movie is really, 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 really bad. It's really bad. Like, it's... This film is a train wreck. This film is It's like Tyler Perry was just like, oh shit, I got a mortgage payment due in 2 weeks. Let me spend a week filming a movie. This film was shot in 8 days, folks.
Oh, really? Oh, yeah. Wow. You know what? I believe
days.
It.
Yeah.
I believe it.
I know you do. Because you'd have to be blind not to see it. Everything about this movie is just like, I mean, Taraji P. Henson is, I think she's a bit typecast. Yeah, she was very, I was pleasantly surprised with her performance in Hidden Figures.
Yes.
Because I quite frankly did not think she could do it. She plays the black woman with a bad attitude in virtually everything I've seen her in.
Mm-hmm.
And now that I've seen her in Hidden Figures and I know that she can do other stuff, I really, really wish she would. Yo, this film is all over the place. There's nobody to root for in this film. Nothing really makes sense. Like, I cannot give this a non-recommendation. I can't tell people emphatically enough to not go see this movie. But at the same time, I kind of want you to see it, right? Like,
no. You gotta see this.
Like,
movie.
This film is so, like, it's a train wreck, right? And nobody wants to see like a 14 car pileup. Like, you don't want to see it, but it's a 14 car pileup. Like, how many times are you gonna see a 14 car pileup?
Yeah, you gotta. Like, if it's there, you gotta look.
If it's there, watch it. That's it. That's what we'll give this film. If it's there, watch it. Don't pay to see it. And don't even risk stealing it. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, that's not worth going to jail.
It's not going to jail. It's not. Don't let this film fuck up your life, man.
Like it did ours.
Yeah. Yeah. This is a thumbs down, man. This is a no out of five. This is on like a pure movie standpoint. But as far as spectacle, like, if you like bad movies, like really bad movies, like movies that just really stink, then if you like getting mad, then this is the movie for you. If you are feeling in a good mood and you want to piss yourself off, go watch this.
Oh, my life.
Okay. Tiara, what was your thoughts?
So I love this movie. I thought it was fantastic. I really... You know, like Micah said, it is a bad movie, but I thoroughly enjoyed watching it. I spent 2 hours of my life watching this movie on pause and then unpause, and I paused it again because, you know, I just wanted to prolong the experience.
Or you went to do something else, like do laundry.
Yeah.
Or anything else.
Anything else. No, I hated this movie. I really did. I really want those 2 hours of my life back. This is a bad movie, and this movie did actually piss me off. The casting was really inconsistent. Like, young Taraji looks like Rihanna, and, and then grows up to look like Taraji Henson. I'm like, okay.
And then the woman who she has a real problem with at the end of the movie, I won't spoil it, looks like the young version.
Yes, I was
like, yo, how was that casting off?
And like the actress who played young Taraji's sister actually looks like a young Taraji Henson.
Yeah,
and then,
that's funny.
And then
yeah.
the guy who played the younger version of the husband is like 5'3", maybe 5'4". But then at the end of the movie, his older self is like maybe 6'2". So I don't know if men experience a growth spurt in their 20s.
We don't.
Okay.
I didn't. I don't know.
That
might explain my 5'9 height. I was waiting on my 1 foot shoot up at 23 years old.
5'9". Yeah. So,
This is rude. But, I bring you here as a guest. Kind.
I hated this movie. I want my 2 hours back. Taraji can do better. Like, you know, like Micah said, the only serious role I'd seen her in are Benjamin Button and Hidden Figures. And she was really good in both of those movies, but I'm really tired of her playing these roles where she is just the crazy woman and there's no substance to her character. Like, I can see if this movie had a good plot and her character was actually developed, but it was none of those things. And I read an article where she was like, well, if it's a good script and if I really enjoy it, I, you know, don't want to forget where I come from. And I'm like, yeah, girl, but you don't need to do every Tyler Perry movie, okay? If Tyler Perry comes knocking, you can just say no. Give it to some other young actress who's on the come up, but this is, nah, she's better than this.
Yeah. Do you have a score?
Oh, like, can I go like negative?
You can do whatever you whatever you want.
Oh, okay.
There ain't no rules here.
Score don't mean nothing.
Negative 10 out of 5.
God damn.
Don't see it. don't even do it while you're, don't even watch it while you're doing laundry. Don't watch it for free. If it's on, just change the channel. Watch something else.
Literally anything.
Anything else.
Yeah. Okay. It's really mean. Poor Tyler Perry. Okay. So Micah mentioned.
Give me a dollar, nigga.
Yeah, well, that's true. Micah mentioned that the movie was shot in 8 days. And you're right. It shows. Look, I thought it was shot poorly. It was written poorly. I mean, it was shot in 8 days, but I assume that it was only written in a day.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, that's what it feels like. It's shot poorly. It's written poorly. The acting is really phoned in. To both of your points, Taraji P. Henson is better than this.
And why is she wearing light blue contacts?
Why is there a guy, a preacher or whatever, wearing a terrible wig? Like, I don't know what that is about Tyler Perry, that he does, like, strange things like that. Like, that's his signature. Is like, there's got to be a black man in a stupid wig in the background.
Who's wearing a wig?
It was, like, at a church or something. I'll point it out if I can find it. I thought overall this movie was just trash. Like, just... the worst of his impulses as a director and as a writer. There was no editor, right? Like, I assume there was just no editor involved in this whatsoever. Whatever he thought, he just threw up on the screen, and then they just were like, cut. Let's
and he's
just
better than this too. Tyler Perry is also better than this.
He is. And in fairness to him as well. Yeah. Taraji P. Henson is too good for this. Lyric Bent, who plays Robert, he's too good for this. He's very good in She's Gotta Have It, the TV series on Netflix. Yeah, I mean, you don't have to do everything that Tyler Perry calls to ask you to do. Like, I feel like it hurts your career, doesn't help it. At a certain point in the movie, I wasn't sure if Taraji P. Henson was going to really even be in it. I thought it was only going to be the young people, because that went on for way too long, I thought. Yeah, this is bad. Like, this is really bad. This might be the worst movie he's done.
Yeah.
I would argue it's his...
Not including a Madea movie.
Yeah, because the Madea movies are like the earnest movies.
I would rather watch a Madea movie over this any day. either the play or like the actual play adaptions.
On the Chitlin circuit?
Yeah, I would, because this...
I mean, the only one I could think of, and I haven't seen it, is like Madea Goes to Jail. I probably wouldn't see that. I don't think I'd see that over this.
You know,
but that's about it.
Taraji did I Can Do Battle by Myself.
I saw that movie.
I didn't see it. So was that good or was it better than this?
Okay, yeah. Those are two very different questions. No, it was not good. Yes, it was better than
this.
She
had the same haircut, that's all, for some reason.
She looked really good in that. Like, she did. I was like, this movie's bad. But I like, because I don't think I really knew who she was when I saw it. And I was like, but I like what's going on here. Like,
wow. Yeah.
That was the one Tyler Perry movie where I was like, oh, the bad guy was like kind of a light skinned black dude.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, I changed it. But then they made the hero Latino. I was like, oh, look, he trumped him. He was even lighter. Well, of course.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Of course.
Good.
Yeah.
So of course this one, the bad guy in this movie, of course, another dark skinned black man. But
was
there
a bad guy?
Right. Like, that's the thing is, there, like I said, there is nobody to root for in this
movie. I was rooting for somebody towards the end, but we'll get there.
Yeah, okay, that's fair. Like, this movie sucks, guys. Yes. It sucks. But as we do, we are going to make, we are going to have fun
we're
with
not
this
play
terrible,
the movie. We're just not
going to
play the movie?
No. If you're watching this on YouTube, this is a review where we talk about the movie. This is not a place where you can watch it for free, you trifling heifers. Go spend your money and just go rent it.
It's like five or $6 on Amazon.
Yeah, I paid to see it. All right, Micah, take us through it. My score, by the way, is a zero. It's a solid fucking zero, because there's way too much green screen on things that you could have just gone out to a park.
You could have just walked outside, man. Yeah, you could have walked outside. So, what are you doing, man? Yeah. What are you doing? It costs more
to green screen it.
Green screen it.
Maybe they could get the permits to film in front of a harbor.
That shit made me so angry. I was like, yo, this is not necessary.
Or maybe, like, you know, on a boat, you know.
Yeah, that boat was in a tank.
You could see like the cylindrical, like
like just outside of the camera view. Anyway, please take us through it. Jesus Christ.
I may change my score depending on how the review goes.
Yeah, I feel like I'm gonna head to the negative very soon.
So we get some establishing shots of where we're at, and apparently this all takes place in Pittsburgh. Strike one.
That's fair.
I thought it was Boston for a second.
Nah. You would think it was Boston because it's so foggy
dreary. Why is it so dreary?
It's Pittsburgh.
You know what? There was something else I wanted to say in my quick like little mini review. This has the same quality of those like cheap, really cheap black movies that we've done, like Insecure and stuff like that. It has that quality where I've come to expect at least a level of... not high quality, but a level of higher quality than that with the Tyler Perry movies.
Yeah,
doesn't this feel like an Insecure type level movie to
yes.
you?
Yeah, it feels like a street, you know, straight to DVD.
Yeah.
You know, let's use Getty Images to create some weird amalgamation for a poster.
You can see the watermark too.
What's the other movies that we do? The Preacher ones?
Yeah, The Preacher's Son and hopefully soon the choir director and
it has that level of quality
3B.
Yeah. It has that level of quality in filmmaking, although those movies are infinitely better
than
this.
At least Man in 3B was like, it was bad but it was like entertaining.
Yeah,
it wasn't like
I
didn't
wanted
hate
to know what happened at the end of
Do they go on to her giving amazing blowjobs on the islands or whatever,
like,
the hell they ended up
like with this movie. This movie, when I saw it was 2 hours, I was like, yo, really?
This should have been an hour and 15 minutes.
And I read the synopsis, like, due to technical difficulties, when I was watching it, I decided to read the synopsis. And then when I read it, I was like, yo, I was like, I don't think I can finish this. Because it was so, it made me so mad. I am offended as a woman. I am offended.
You should have been. You should be offended as a person with a brain.
Well.
Just in general.
So... the film, we established that we're in Pittsburgh, and we cut to a courtroom scene where Melinda, played by Taraji P. Henson, is being reprimanded by a judge. Basically, he's like, look, you're going to have to pay attention to me, or you're going to have to do what I say, or you're going to jail. So he was like, look, I'm sentencing you to counseling. And then we cut to Taraji sitting on a couch in a counselor's office. And the counselor's asking her, you know, all these questions and stuff. And you realize that this is a serious Tyler Perry movie, because Taraji P. Henson can't wait to start cussing.
Yeah, buddy.
He's like, fuck, do I look like I'm thinking? Fuck. Like,
These are my favorite Tyler Perry movies, though, right? Like, this one's bad, but I don't like the Madea ones. I like when he's trying. Like, when he's really this movie, he's not really trying.
Yeah, I was about to say, he's not really trying.
Is this an experiment to see if black people will just see anything he puts out?
It has to be. How much money does this movie make?
$46 million.
It doubled his budget.
Doubled his budget.
Are you serious?
Yeah. I mean, are you surprised?
Kind of.
Black people will come out for Tyler Perry just about $50 million every single time.
Wow.
Every time.
Plus Taraji P. Henson being on the poster.
That'll do it too.
Yeah, that's true. Like, man, that's why Taraji P. Henson's in it. That's why he gets her to do it. Because it wouldn't have made money if Aloysius, or whatever that woman's name is, that played the younger version of her, A-J-I-O-N-A.
Lil Rihanna?
That? Yeah, Lil Rihanna. If she was...
Agione?
Something.
Agiona Alexis?
Alexis. Mm.
Okay.
Anyway, so Taraji P. Henson's on the couch, and the shrink is basically like, so you think he did you wrong? And she's like, of course that motherfucker did me wrong. He owed me.
What's a pillow top mattress?
She was like, so let's start at the beginning. And we get a flashback for 40 minutes.
Yo, this flashback was way too long. I was like, yo, Taraji P. Henson's not in this movie.
No, because they had to show you the definition.
Right. And then we get the first the
fuck off,
the
Tyler.
The film is broken up into five different stages. And the first stage is acrimony, which, you know, means bitterness. And we see that Melinda meets her dream guy named Robert Gale on a rainy night. She's coming out of college and she's running out and she runs into him. And then she starts cussing him out, like, what the fuck? Because all her papers drop and all
and
that.
And she starts hitting him,
and then
too.
She starts hitting on him and wailing on him. Like, what the fuck? Like, you ran on me, lady?
Yeah, she's the normal one.
I was like, that took me by surprise. I was like, what? How did we get here? Like, what did he do? Turns out, like, nah, he just bumped into her.
Like, yo, nah, like.
And then she left her papers on the ground.
And she starts, you know, she starts hit. That shit pissed me off, man.
She windmilled him, though.
Yeah, she did. She did. She did one of them, like, girl fight type things where she's like,
sit down and calm down.
So, Robert goes to her dorm room and just like, hey, you left some papers. You probably won't be able to read anything on these papers because ink tends to run in the rain, but I was looking at them while I was walking in the rain, and I don't have no umbrella or nothing, but, you know.
Instead of using the papers over my head.
But he gives her the papers, and you hear Taraji P. Henson giving voiceover, like, oh, he was handsome. I'll give him that. The devil makes a good package. And he was handsome and dark. And so Robert Gale is a...
Is this part speaking to you?
Like, I'm just thinking, like, what... Like, what dude would come back to your dorm room to give you your papers after you just assaulted him in the middle of the rain? Are you doing that? 18. Wow, they probably 18.
No, woman hit me, yo.
Like that?
I'm gonna have to
open doors for you. No, I'm kidding.
See,
because
you don't. You know, like. You know, I'm chivalrous.
I am.
Jay hates chivalry, guys.
I do. It's dumb. No, I'm not bringing your papers back. You hit me. I'd leave them right in the rain. Fuck off.
I mean, it's not even just the fact that she hit you. It's not like she just push you. She was really, like, wailing on you to the point, like...
No, I'd be like, no, I get it. Not stomp on him and grind him into a fucking mud puddle. What do I care?
And you're not going to, like, offer to tutor her or anything like that?
No. And I'm not sharing any of my found millions later on either. You know, wow. He does something that I would never do.
Really? That's what I was like.
Nah,
I kind of had to root for some. There was somebody to root for towards the end.
No, yeah, that might as well have been a scene out of Lord of the Rings. How much of a fantasy that was. Get the fuck out of here. No. No, yo, absolutely not.
Yeah,
good hearty handshake.
So wow. he goes and he stalks her, because that's what that was, right? Stalking. He stalks her and gives her papers back, and he's like, hey, I can tutor you. I took that guy's class. I could tutor you. So they start, you know, tutoring and getting to know each other. And later on, we see them walking. She failed the class because she's stupid. And
yeah, like, what kind of resolution was that? Hey, I tutored you. Yeah, I got a D anyway. What the fuck, dude?
So either she's dumb or he's a bad tutor.
Right. Either one. Either way, I'm not rooting for anybody.
By the way, I don't know. I guess this was supposed to be in the 90s at this time?
Yeah.
Yo, she...
Yes, 1996, to be specific.
Okay, I will say this. The one thing he gets right, yo, she is dressed like a girl in 1996 yeah. to the T. It is really quite funny. I just catching that image, I was like, wow, okay, yeah, that was actually pretty.
And remember, Robert is like super smart because he's like an engineering.
He's major, a chemical right? engineering student.
Okay, he's working on this battery.
Yes, the
super battery,
the battery that can recharge itself. And these things do.
That's not a thing.
These things. They don't exist. Not the way they exist, but not the way it is portrayed in the movie.
Yeah,
where it's just an unlimited source of energy. Right. Like, no, that does not exist.
That's like a perpetual energy machine. Right. If they found that, it'd be a cure for everything.
So just real quick,
just put them in cars.
That one right there, right, the one on the left.
Yo, she is a raging bitch to him for no reason.
But doesn't she look like Taraji Henson though?
She kind of does.
She should be playing young Taraji. That's what I mean.
Yeah.
The girl that is playing Taraji P. Henson in this movie played a young version of Taraji P. Henson's character in Empire, if that does anything for you.
It does.
Wait,
not.
What? Who?
So the woman, the young Melinda,
mm-hmm.
played, it was young in Cookie. Empire. She played young Cookie in Empire. So right. okay. in the Tyler Perry cinematic universe.
Who does Empire? Continuity. Is that Lee Daniels?
Lee Daniels. That's Lee Daniels.
What's the difference?
Okay.
Right.
You know what?
You know what the major difference is? One of them doesn't have to get harassed by
Monique.
No. What's the guy? Jay-Z's old friend.
Oh, Dame Dash.
Yeah, Dame Dash yelling at him about where his fucking $2 million is.
I mean,
Dame Dash wasn't wrong.
Yeah.
I mean, he was wrong about not having a boss. That stupid ass philosophy.
If you're not a what do you say?
If you're not your own boss, like basically blow your brains out. It's like, yo, what kind of logic is that? You have employees. It's like, nah, fuck them.
Like, so he's
okay.
He doesn't provide his employees benefits, guys.
He definitely doesn't. He's like, nah, fuck healthcare. Get a new boss, your own boss. I'm like, okay.
So once we find out that Melinda failed her test that they were tutoring for, you see them walk in and we see her sisters, and her sisters tell her that their mom died.
God damn. Yo, the level of like the hits is like Mississippi Dam. Like stab. Like, all right. Negative news we need.
So Robert is like, oh, you know, I'm sorry, and I'll be there to comfort you and all that.
You going to the funeral? You just start dating a girl on Mondays?
No, I ain't going to nobody's funeral. Not
really?
I
would go to a funeral.
To this woman that you just met?
Yeah, I would.
Well, he
if I was
up,
trying to get laid, yeah, I would.
He showed up. Wow.
Well, that's
I mean, he is, yeah. okay? Yeah, he is.
Yeah.
He is.
I mean, well, he showed up after the funeral, so I guess that's a more
no,
a
he
more
was there.
Time.
No, really? He was there.
He was at the wake.
Yeah.
No, he came to the funeral. I'm looking at it. He was.
I thought he... You know, actually...
No, they're at the funeral, and he came, and he's dressed like it's 1996, too, because he's got the sweater with
like,
the white...
Does
the V-neck with the white T-shirt.
Yeah, V-necks don't look good with a crew neck undershirt.
Yeah, that was... But that was
don't wear them.
Yeah, that's what we used to do.
I like how, like, for the also with the casting, the two people that they kept the same were the brother-in-laws.
Are they the same guys?
I think so.
No, I don't think so. Oh. Like, that guy's, like, mad young.
Mm. One of the niggas look like Chris Brown.
They're two different. They're two different people.
Oh, okay. At
Devin and Young Devin.
Yeah. I do like the dialogue between the sister and Robert. She's like, "So how do you know my sister?" He's like, "Oh, from school." And then the immediate next question is, "So what do you do for a living?" And he's like, "School. Like, I'm a student." They're like, "You ain't got no job." I'm in school. I'm sorry. Does your sister have a job? She's too dumb to pass this physics test.
How do you pay for school then? What the fuck? How does anybody pay for school?
Well, okay. But
borrow and hope for the best.
He has to take her out, you know, because she can't pay for anything.
That's true. That's true. So he should pay for everything from his non-existent
job. See what happens when you an unchivalrous nigga, like in this movie?
Yeah. So up until a point, it worked out pretty well.
Well, you know, he should have.
I'm on that Robert Gale bag. Like, nah,
he should have spoiled her. Like, you know.
Yeah, he did. All right.
Well.
Oh man.
This is a tale of somebody who doesn't believe in chivalry.
So. So they're at the funeral and
that dude looks like Chris
gets the third degree from the sisters and Melinda takes Robert home, and his home is this RV on the other side of the tracks.
It's like a row of like really nice houses, and then like 5 feet over it's the trailer.
Yeah, she was like, "Oh, is this your house?" "Nah, it's the trailer over there." Like,
and she's like, "Oh, well,
this is quaint."
this looks really, you know, homely and humble and nice and sweet.
So does he own the trailer?
They never said that.
Because where are his parents?
That they never explained it either.
This shit is ridiculous, yo. They live in a cul-de-sac, and then there's a fucking trailer right there. Come on, yo.
You know what? That's Tyler Perry's cul-de-sac. He had that fucking trailer delivered. He did. He was like, "Nah, fuck it. Don't worry about it."
Like, they hop over a speed bump, and then the shit, like, it's a cul-de-sac. It's a residential neighborhood.
And also, like, you know, the area around it changes, so it's, like, dirtier. And unkempt compared to, like, the houses that are right next door.
Wow, yo. Wow.
This movie is wild.
So they go to his place, and Robert introduces her to the music of Nina Simone, and she's apparently still grieving, and Robert is like, "Oh, you're beautiful," and then he kisses her, and then Taraji P. Henson comes in and is like, "What was I supposed to do? I was grieving. What kind of man takes advantage of a grieving girl? He took my virginity."
He didn't take it from you. You gave it up. Two, grief and like sexual attraction, that they go together. Like, that is not uncommon.
Yeah, yeah. That's why these things say you're never supposed to fall in love with Superman, right? Like, you're not supposed to fall in love with someone who rescues you.
Right, exactly.
Because you don't know them. Like, you all horned up and shit, like, "Whoa! Henry Cavill just fucking saved me from a falling building. Let's fuck." And then you find out that motherfucker's fucking 19-year-olds.
I don't know what she's talking about.
Stop trying to ignore history. That's a real thing. Yeah, so I didn't like the fact that she's like, they tried to make that into a negative. Like, no, that's...
She was into it, though.
Of course she was into it. But grief, I mean, grief is... I'm sure there are a lot of people who, after a funeral, just like an emotional thing. Like, if you don't go home and fuck. Because it's something that feels good.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, all right. Yeah, I mean, I had no problem with this part.
You're going, Robert. What do you think?
Actually, one of my favorite scenes in the movie, it does have to do with the trailer.
I also enjoy that scene.
So Melinda's sisters, June and Brenda, are leery of Robert. They are skeptical because she thinks that... They think that Melinda told Robert about the inheritance that was given to her. And apparently none of the other sisters.
Yeah, okay. So did he ever, like, so the other sisters didn't get inheritance?
Apparently the other sisters didn't get any money, guys.
Because I was wondering.
That shit doesn't make any sense.
I was like, why are y'all struggling? Did your mother not give you anything?
Right.
And is Melinda the youngest sister?
I think she is the youngest. She don't look like it when they get older, though.
No, she doesn't.
I would argue that is correct.
But she gets $350,000?
$325,000.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so the sisters think that Melinda told Robert that, and that's why Robert's here all of a sudden. And they're like, nah, yo, nah, I don't trust this guy.
I would just like to point out this moment in the movie of what her sister asked Melinda.
Yo, who's paying for you when y'all go out on dates? Come on, yo. Yo, black women, yo, like, do for yourself before you. Don't be relying on no man to take care of you.
You know.
Can you pay my bills, my telephone bills?
Yeah. I'm an independent woman. Wow, the two songs together? That's amazing.
Well, I mean, if he wants to.
Did Beyonce play both those songs at the
concert? She certainly did not. Yeah, she certainly did not.
Wait, was it, did she play Ring the Alarm? That crazy song?
I think she did. Yeah, I think she did.
I'd be damned if I see another chick on your arm.
Yeah, okay. She did. Yeah, she did. I saw the Beyonce concert last night, guys. And look, Beyonce.
He gets it now.
I get it.
He gets it. Welcome.
And she super fine. God damn. You know what's not super fine? This fucking green screen of these two walking down on the pier on the boardwalk. Right, and it's so bad.
Three-quarter
length shot, so you can't see their feet, and it looks like a ViewMaster is in the background. Like, it's so bad, right?
Why did they green screen
that? And this is how bad the effects and the effects in this movie are. Look, I've said on countless occasions that I love my lovely wife, but my wife does not know the difference. Between an image that is in 480 interlaced and an image that is in 1080 progressive. And she is able to point out this bullshit.
She was like, nah, this is trash.
She was like, come on, yo. This is blue screen like a motherfucker. And I was like, well, they technically is green screen, but yeah. It's
the same you got it. We on the same page.
Really bad. God.
This is
also
terrible.
Take note that Melinda and Robert are the same height. Mm. Like, they are literally like head to head, like forehead to forehead. But you know, Robert will be a good 6'3" by the end of the film. Because apparently money makes you grow.
Apparently.
Hey, I need more money. Sticking in my shoes. Like newspapers or some shit. I don't know.
So these two are walking around and walking around on this green screen lot, and Robert is, you know, talking about his big dreams, and he's like, yeah, I got this idea for this perpetual motion battery, or this battery that can, you know, refill itself, and I'm going to make $1 billion, and I'm going to have a boat over there, and it's going to have Mr. and Mrs. Gale on it, and I think I'm going to call it Robert Super Battery. And she's like, why don't you call it Gale Force Wind? Which also doesn't make sense, because the battery is not wind powered. Like, I don't know. It just bothered me.
Why, you could have just called it Gale Force.
Right. But all right.
And there was something else.
Again, that's something he wrote in 30 minutes.
Yeah.
Like, Gale Force Wind.
He didn't have any consultants on staff when he wrote this film.
Yeah, somebody was like, Gale Force Wind doesn't make any sense.
Like, and also, like, in this conversation, he tells her, like, I don't like to be disappointed by other people. And she's like, I'll never disappoint you. And I'm like, And that's when I thought that they were to make him, you know, the villain.
Yeah.
And well.
So, okay. Here's my question. Here's a quick aside. And you were right. I'm sorry. I thought it was 325 is how much she was in. She was actually given 350, but she burned 25,000 on a Mustang immediately.
Because
she
bought him a fucking Mustang. Yo. She bought him a car, a brand new car.
Like, no.
Because, all right, so Robert is trying to get to Prescott, the only venture capitalist in the world.
Yeah, the only one.
There might be the only one in Pittsburgh, because, I mean, ain't
I mean, isn't Philadelphia, like, just a couple hours away, or New York, or D.C., or Baltimore? No.
I mean, New York City? Nah, you can't get there. You can't get there from here. Like, you couldn't get from Pittsburgh to New York City.
There's not a train?
With a perpetual motion machine or whatever the fuck.
This movie is getting... I'm just getting mad over it.
We're only 15 minutes in, or 20 minutes into it.
So Melinda buys him a car so that he can, you know, get to, you know, Prescott or whatever.
It's funny because you could have done that in a Toyota.
But yeah, you didn't have to get a Mustang or convertible.
Or with a fucking bus pass. What?
Okay.
She could have just bought him like one of those bus passes where you could
unlimited.
Unlimited. He don't need a car.
Like a monthly. Like, that's love. A monthly bus pass and you ain't got nothing? Shit, you married that guy. You got that. Yo, she bought me a monthly bus pass. I'm going to go buy a ring next week.
Yeah.
Wait, so what's your question?
Question I'm going to ask? So, no, it's not a problematic question. That's very rude. It definitely is. as a woman, is this a telltale sign? Like, this guy's like, oh, I need a Mustang convertible. And you got $350,000. You start to feel like, maybe I don't trust this guy.
No, it's over.
Damn, already. You're not buying him like a Toyota for like a RAV4?
No, I'm not buying you anything. I'm not buying you a new car.
What about a 4Runner?
No, if we're just dating.
No.
I don't even, look.
I can't imagine buying someone a car that I was just dating.
Yo, okay.
Let me tell you something, yo. My birthday last year, I went and bought a Jeep. And I took a picture of it because I was happy, right? Mm-hmm. My wife said, don't post that because I don't want people thinking that I bought you a car for your birthday. My wife said
see?
That.
And I agree with that.
Nigga, I ain't no sucker.
First of all,
don't post that.
Listen,
that's fucking funny.
I'm not going to say I'm a selfish person. Mm. But I don't like buying people things.
You after my own heart.
I don't want to say I'm a selfish person, but I don't like giving.
We might be cousins.
Like
black people are. Yeah,
unless you have four legs and you look like a retriever mix, I honestly don't want to buy you anything. So no, I'm not buying you a fucking car just because you fucked me at my mom's funeral and you told me about your big dreams. I don't give a fuck, nigga. You're in school. You'll be able to buy yourself a car soon.
I mean, that's the right answer.
Okay. All right.
See, it wasn't that problematic. I thought it was just a good question.
I mean, can you say as a woman? I'm like, yeah, as a woman, like the answer's still fucking no.
Yeah, okay. Because I mean, I guess post-funeral sex must have been.
It had to be.
He blew the doors off of her because she was like, here's the Mustang.
She didn't know any better because she was a virgin.
Yeah, but first time?
I mean, but here's the thing. I mean, but maybe. Okay. She really liked that. Well, he did bring back her papers. After she, assaulted him on the street.
Yeah.
And, he did tutor her, but she failed. And he did show up to the funeral. And I don't even know why are they still together at this point?
I don't know. She feels sorry that he lives on the other side of the tracks, I guess.
Okay.
She went and bought this dude a car, right? And we see a couple of scenes of Melinda like, well, I haven't talked to him in a while. Like, I just bought that nigga a car.
Yo, she says she didn't call him for 2 days to see if he'd call her back. And he didn't.
Right. And when she called him, she was like, well, I haven't spoken to you since, I bought you that car. And this trifling ass nigga was like, well, you didn't call me either. Like,
But the way he answered, he was like, hey, how you doing?
Hey,
I was like,
you?
Hey, buddy. How are you doing? How have you been? And she's just like, oh, I haven't heard from you in a while. I'm like, but like, I feel like saying like the way he answers
hey
the phone.
Hey there, how are you?
Like the way that he answers the phone, shouldn't that kind of tell you something?
Apparently it did. Oh. It told her that he was fucking somebody else. So she gets into her Jeep Wrangler, drives over.
How does she have a worse car than him? All right.
Drives over.
Yeah, never that. I'm not driving. No, I'm driving like, a Jeep Wrangler. While you're driving
by you a Mustang.
Nigga, you're wild.
Tyler Perry hates women.
So he.
Yeah.
Yeah, he does.
He does.
He does.
He has a serious problem in the way that he sees women. It's fucked up.
So she drives over in her Jeep, right? And which is another 90s thing, right? Every black person had Jeeps and shit. R. Kelly made songs about, fucking Jeeps that were, and
fucking young women who reminded him of Jeeps.
Yep.
Yeah. And she goes over there. And she looks in and she sees a hand come up like, oh, okay, well, they must be fucking. So what I'm gonna do?
And that trailer was rocking too.
Yeah, that trailer was really rocking. And it's about to rock some more. So she T-bones the trailer And she repeatedly T-bones the trailer until she flips it over. Look.
She could have murdered some people, dude.
You know, okay, but hey, you know, look.
Don't justify that action. What the hell can she do that?
This was the scene that made me go like, okay, all right. So
she's the hero.
So we're getting somewhere. I like the scene.
It was hilarious.
I understand being mad. But, like, aren't there a few more practical ways that you can, like, take your vengeance out on somebody without wrecking your car?
That's my thing.
It's like, I'm not going to ruin my car.
Well, so what would you do in a situation?
Well, I would do what she ended up doing, right? I would take a cinder block, but instead of throwing it in the Mustang, I would have threw it into the goddamn trailer. I would have broke the door down, and I'd have started fucking windmilling them again like it was the beginning of the movie. When they get out, then knock it over. Because look, I just want them to be fucked up. I don't want them to potentially die.
No, that seems like a lot of work.
Up the Mustang, I didn't like, because I'm like, girl, you bought that. Yeah. That's your $25,000 that's going down the drain.
And you fucked up your Jeep by driving it into...
Yeah, I'm just saying, don't fuck up your Jeep, yo.
And that's not the one thing she fucked up.
Don't fuck up... Yeah, yeah, because apparently the seatbelt was too tight, I guess?
She kept hitting the steering wheel.
Yeah, she hit her head on the steering wheel.
She hit her head on the steering wheel, but she also did something to her lady parts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So internal bleeding and stuff like that.
Yeah, so she's unable to... She goes to the hospital. And we find out that she is unable to have children from now on. They had to give her an emergency hysterectomy.
Yeah. And Robert was in a whole ass relationship with the other girl.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
This movie goes in a direction that just doesn't make any sense to me. Like,
it doesn't.
Yo,
and how's Robert getting these girls, yo?
Right, well, this broke ass nigga. Like, what the fuck? How could you possibly be getting girls if you can't afford to pay for dates?
Maybe it's a Mustang. They saw the other Mustang, and then
this nigga's rich.
And then he took him back to his trailer.
He don't got no car payment or nothing. This dude is balling. Because like, she bought that Mustang outright. Dude.
Yeah,
right. She bought that Mustang straight cash.
And the theme for this movie, they like to show us how much money that she's losing over time.
Yeah, so that's really obnoxious. But also hilarious.
I was like, girl, y'all never, she never got an accountant. Her sister's never.
No, they just kept that shit in the Bank of America checking account. Ain't earned a nickel of interest the whole fucking time.
Black
Jesus
people.
Christ. Always keep it in a coffee can because I don't trust a white man with my money. All right.
Black people, please get a wealth manager.
Yeah, I'm going to need you to open an IRA or something. God damn.
So while Melinda is recovering, Robert comes to see her. And they reconcile. Now, here's something that is...
The older sister, by the way, just a quick aside. The older sister in this flashback, she is super fine. I just want to point that out.
Like, young Taraji?
Yeah, she's super, super, super fine.
Not... Well, I think they're all pretty, but the older sister,
yeah,
the one with the dark lips, the lipstick, she's super fine.
Yeah, she really is. I'm a fan. Anyway, continue.
So...
But she was a bitch to Robert for no goddamn reason until this moment, where it is all justified from this moment on to the end.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So she's recovering, right? Robert comes in and they've reconciled. And here's the thing that I don't like about movies. You hear Taraji's voiceover saying something to the effect of, well, I know it was wrong, but... And I know I shouldn't have done it. And I know I'm stupid for doing it, but I did it. Like, just because you point out that you did something stupid, you still did it, movie. Like, it doesn't make any sense.
Right, yeah.
Like, don't call out the stupidness in your movie and think you get a pass.
No, you don't.
You don't.
But I guess that's maybe to equate what people do in reality, right? They're like, I know that's a bad idea, but I love him or I love her. I'm like, if you're aware something is dumb,
then don't do it.
Don't do it.
Right.
I'm like, never if you're old enough to buy this nigga a car, you're old enough to know me doing stupid ass shit. Just stop.
Or if you do it,
more green screen.
If you do it, don't call it out.
Yeah.
Because now you're pointing out one of the faults of the movie to people that might not have caught it.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe. I can see that point.
Anyway, so they're on this green, they're on the same green screen pier in Pittsburgh as they were before. And he's crying because he's like, I don't have any money and I'm not going to be able to graduate. So she's like, all right, let me just drop $73,000 to pay for your tuition.
No. So y'all,
yo, I can't even fathom that.
You're not, so if y'all, so if you had the money.
No.
You really like this girl? You really love this girl?
I wouldn't do it for my kid.
Wow.
That's right.
That's a lie. but I do believe it. About anybody else, yeah. No.
$73,000 just so that he can finish graduating. Also, like, it's insane how...
$73,000 in 1996? No. What fictional school does he go to? College was damn near free back then.
I was about to say, like, I was in kindergarten in 1996. So,
yeah, we were 16 years old.
We were driving.
I was driving too. I was driving my Barbie Jeep around Buffalo Mill.
Yeah, somebody was driving you ass to daycare. Get the fuck out of here.
I was driving it to Greek Village and Golden Dragon, my little Barbie Jeep. but
anytime we do shows with you or Carrie, it's just like, Jesus Christ, we are fucking old.
Yeah, that's true. crap. Now, what I was going to say.
Well, all I know is they're back at a green screen again.
Oh yeah, wait. That I was about to say. Like, so, like, were like student loans not a thing?
No, 1997 is when student loans were invented, apparently, according to this fucking universe.
Because I'm like, he couldn't like get a loan to go to school, or
the brilliant genius kid,
or you know, I know this is
what about the loans he already had that he said he already had.
Was he on a scholarship?
Yeah, he said loan scholarships and grants. And
there's one other thing he could have done, you know, to help fund his education. It's called, and this is a theme throughout the movie, get a job. Get a job.
He could have.
Yeah, he could have. But, you know, his girl was like a bank to him.
So.
Yeah, but see, and this is that moment where I'm like, this nigga's a scumbag.
Yeah.
This is a scumbag.
Trifling, yeah.
Yeah, he is.
So,
trifling is the correct one.
He gets his tuition paid for, and I guess the least he feels that he can do is marry this girl. So he takes her to.
See, I don't like any of that shit. I ain't marrying you if I'm not married.
He gave her a ring, pop ring.
He takes her to a gazebo and gives her, and proposes. He gets down on one knee and he opens up the jewelry box, and all of a sudden, bam, a ring from Claire's department store.
I thought it was a ring pop.
And he's like, will you marry me? Like, no, I know it's
I
not
got
a
you an onion
yet.
Ring.
And
she took it, dummy.
And she took it because she was like, I know this was dumb, but I loved him.
He pulled out a chair for me once. It was great. That means he a real man.
So we cut to the two sisters, and the two sisters are like, yo, this is the stupidest thing I've ever heard of. If you marry him, we're not coming.
So my wife has a friend like that.
Oh, really?
Melinda?
No.
Like the sisters?
Like the sister. She was like, because my wife was dating this guy previously, and then she was like, if y'all would have gotten engaged, she was like, I wasn't coming to the wedding. She was like, nah, fuck that, dude.
So would
and she was not playing, dude. She was 100% serious.
Would y'all do that for like your siblings if you found out that you're...
I'd do it for a good friend. If he was marrying some fucking psychopath who I thought was damaging, I'd be like, I'm not coming to that. I'm not supporting that. Fuck out of here.
Yeah.
But shouldn't that be like a message to you, like... If people who are close to you, people who have known you, are like, yeah, I hate this person so much for you that I am not coming to celebrate.
It should be a message to you. But I mean, people take that, you know, like you have to be very careful, right? Because if you don't like a good friend or a sibling's significant other and it's a serious relationship, you have to be careful to like, be able to say that to them without pissing them off and driving them into the hands of that person. Because that's actually what happens with her, right? But, like, your ex, you know, that you were dating before you and your wife got together, like, I told you. I was like, this is a bad idea.
Yeah.
And I had to couch that shit in, like, a way that wasn't offensive to him so that he wasn't like,
I love her and I hate you, and then run off. Like,
so what was the breaking point? When did you finally see the light?
When she left me.
Oh, jeez. I mean, that's a pretty good. I think this isn't going well.
Wow. I'm so sorry.
Yeah, yeah. She way to bring up old shit.
No, she quite literally told me that she didn't want to marry me after she, you know, I proposed, she accepted. A couple months later, she told me she didn't want to marry me and didn't want to be in a relationship as she was going out the door to, what's that thing in Boston?
Penny Arcades.
To PAX East.
PAX East, yeah. I'm going to play video games. Peace, nigga.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
I even got Street Fighter 3.
Wow. Yeah. That is.
So I was right then.
Yeah.
I am so sorry.
Don't be sorry.
And then she called him. I'm like, concerned. I just wanted to make sure the mic is okay.
I was like, he's fine.
Because if she really wanted to do it right, she would have sat you down and talked to you. Not like, okay, well, here's your ring. I'll see you later. I'm gonna go play some video games. Okay. I don't really want to get married though, so peace.
What? I mean, I feel like you don't really know her, because like that was pretty accurate.
That's pretty much what it was.
Yeah.
But, ooh, well, you know. Dodge that bullet.
Oh, yeah, like the fucking Matrix, my guy.
Erica is amazing.
Yes, she is quite amazing. She's quite amazing.
And I've never said, hey, I don't think this is a good idea. No, I was like, marry her, nigga. What are you doing?
Right. Yeah. What are you doing?
Hurry up before she figures the shit out about you. Robert, your battery isn't working. Just marry her. Hurry up.
you trapped her?
No, I almost fucked that up, too. Almost fucked that up. Yeah, because I had jumped into that right after the previous one.
Oh no!
And I wasn't ready. So I told her, look, I don't think I'm ready for this. And then I dated around for a while. And I said to Jay, I was like, man, you know, I really missed that Erica girl. And he was like, well, go ahead and fucking do it then.
Is that your impression of me?
Yeah. Like, well, go get her, dude. Dude, I told you.
All right, that's actually pretty good. That's all right.
Oh, and she was just right there.
So I started. That's why I opened up a Facebook account.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. I opened up a Facebook account when I was like 27.
Wow.
Everybody else had it for 9 years.
Everybody. Right. Exactly. But I read somewhere that women, they want to stalk you to make sure that you're not a stalker if they meet you online.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And that's how we met online. Match.com. It works. Hmm.
There are a lot of unions that happen online.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Pay for them. Pay for that. Don't go to like Plenty of Fish or whatever unless you're just trying to fuck.
Yeah. That's true.
That's all that is.
And don't use Tinder. Tinder's kind of creepy.
Yo, Tinder is the epitome of just grossness.
Yeah, you just want to bang.
Nope, you're ugly. You're ugly. You're ugly. Oh, okay. Maybe you. Like, that is about
the least level of effort you can put into the dating world.
Right.
Swiping till you find someone you're like, I would stick my penis in you. Yep, that's
yeah. That's about right.
They like, there's barely a profile. It's just a face.
Or it's so annoying when you're on Tinder and you see a guy and he has like a girl in his picture, and you're like, you're like, who is that? Like, why is or like you see a person and they have like four other dudes in the picture and you don't know which guy is which, and you find out it's always the ugly one.
That's why he tries to surround himself. He's just hoping like the law of averages
and,
it'll work
and
out
and like
him.
You find out that he's actually like towards like the corner or the side or in the back, and like the hot guy's actually in front, and you're like, oh, that's him. And then you realize like, no.
You go through like the fourth picture, like, the commonality here is your ugly ass.
Like, false advertising. Just be yourself.
Wow.
Or not.
I am glad that I dated in the era of pre-Tinder.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Nah, that's a bad idea. I don't need that.
So, they get married. And
ain't nobody come.
They get married and years go by. And as the years go by...
Oh, there it is. The fucking preacher. What is going on with that hair?
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah.
He's got a great value version of Steve Harvey's high-top fade wig.
So they get married and they show the passage of time by the amount of money that is depleting in Melinda's account. And
take out a loan
to the point where they are in the red. Robert is unable to find work because lo and behold, he's a felon. He committed a felony at 16.
I remember this part, and I remember just like this is before I read the rest of the movie, but I was like, girl, you need to just kick him out, just get a divorce, do whatever you need to do. It's not too late. And she was just like, why didn't you tell me? And then she forgives him. Also, her character completely changes after the incident when she pretty much almost kills him and the other chick. Now she's like super docile for...
She's just worn down.
Yeah, she's like super submissive now.
Which is kind of odd.
Yeah, it was.
Is that not what we're supposed to say?
I'm kidding. Taraji says that in the beginning, where she's like, "I was strong when he needed me strong. I played weak when he needed me to play weak." I think that's what.
Yeah, that's this what that is.
Oh, okay.
I used to be a lot quieter of a person. Believe it or not.
No.
So
I know. No, I'm serious.
Robert,
you don't believe me. All right, fine. Don't believe my lies. It's all right.
So Robert had spent 2 years in prison, and he didn't tell his wife that.
Maybe that's why he doesn't. Maybe that's why he doesn't have loans, right? Because you can't. Can you get? I don't think you can get federal loans if you're a felon.
I think you might be right, but yeah. Does?
But there's no way Tyler Perry thought about that.
Does charges like that get expunged when you turn into an adult?
Probably depends on it.
Yeah.
What did he do? Did he like rob someone?
Somebody at a store or some shit? I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. He committed a felony. Robert
probably stalking someone outside of a venture capital company for 40 fucking years.
So Robert convinces Melinda to take a mortgage out on the house because they don't have any money.
Yo,
so he takes
she
a mortgage
is a
out
dummy.
On the house that was gifted to her.
Yeah, that was already paid off.
So that he could build his prototype, you know, super battery.
That doesn't make any sense.
So
how does that happen?
So I have a question for y'all. Let's say you're Melinda, and you're not as dumb as she is, but your significant other is trying to build something, like has a side hustle, but she's not, you know, getting a job. What are you doing?
No, you can't have a job.
And then, your side hustle has to be making money.
But yeah, then, your side hustle has to be your side hustle. That's right. The whole point of the side part.
Like, this is my side hustle. I have a job that pays actual money until it gets not close, but until this is making a good amount of money, then I will leave my job. I can't just be like, I'm out and just hope podcasting makes it. Like, nah, yo, that's
but
crazy.
But what if you find out that your wife has a record and that's why she can't find a job? And you're just now finding this out. They're,
I would be
is
furious.
Are you going to stick it out or is it over?
No, it wouldn't be. Yeah, it wouldn't be over, but okay. I would be furious.
Yeah.
All right.
No, I'd be furious. I'd be like, don't lie to me, yo. If I found out my wife had a fucking felony and it's just like, I just didn't mention that shit. Like, yeah. I stabbed somebody back in 2000. I'd be like, yo, what the fuck?
Because it's also important note here. Like, she thought she was about to get a break because he had like 3 job offers that were like 6-figure jobs. Coming right out of college, and he had interviews for them. He was actually recruited for them.
Okay. See, this is the type of thing I'm talking about with writing. Writing is really important. Oh, the director's really cool. No. Writing is really important.
Yeah.
If I am a business and I recruit a 22-year-old, 23-year-old, who's like a super genius, and he's going to make this battery, and it's all is going to be great.
Yep.
If I go out of my way to recruit him, one, I already have done my due diligence, so right. I know that he's a felon.
Right.
Also, he's a felon at 16.
Right.
That's a far different thing than being a college student at 22, a college graduate.
And in chemical engineering at that.
Yeah. Like, the whole ban the box thing and everything else is a real problem.
Right.
But if they recruit you, that's generally not a problem. If I go, hey, here's some money I want to give you, I don't go, hey, wait a minute. Whoa, who wrote this down?
Like, but just good money at that time. considering
$100,000 in 1996.
Yeah, coming right out of school.
Yeah, come on, dog. Like so this, that
this, whole, this how you know this is a movie,
right? Mm-hmm. That whole thing, right? No, that whole writing just was poor. That didn't make any sense to me.
So years go by. Melinda is working to support the both of them. They mortgage the house. And then 20 years go by. They've been doing this for 20 years.
She's working two jobs.
And he couldn't get a job at fucking McDonald's.
Right. Like, nah, you didn't have a job for 20 years? Like, that doesn't make sense.
So how long are you sticking it out?
For somebody to get a job as an adult?
Mm-hmm.
5. 2.5.
I'm like, five
was a long time, dude. That was a long time to be hitting up two incomes. Nah,
because you're
not even trying. Like, right. if you got a McDonald's job, and you flipping burgers, you bring in a little bit of money, you're at least trying.
Because she went to go work at her best friend's, her college roommate / best friend's company as office assistant, and then at night she was a janitor. And yet he's at home still stalking this venture capitalist firm and still working on his battery. And I think that's also the irritating thing, that it was just one firm that he was trying to pitch.
It's just one venture capitalist.
I'm like, y'all. And like to the point where even this firm is like, please stop writing letters. Please stop calling us. Yeah. We are getting your messages. We are not responding on purpose. And
it shit doesn't make any sense.
So 20 years go by.
20 years without a job. Yeah, I would stab that nigga in the middle of the night. there's no way, yo.
Like, that doesn't make any sense. Like, no. It makes sense because of the age of the actors, right? Like, you wanted to cast these people, but maybe you could have cast somebody else.
Yeah.
Wait, maybe you just could have kept these people.
Right.
So you wanted to cast Lyric Bennett or Bent and Taraji P. Henson. Yo, 20 years is a real long time, yo.
To not have a job.
Mm-mm. It's a generation.
It's
a generation of not working.
Every single day. And to be supporting your marriage and that house and the upkeep of that house. That was a pretty big house.
No, okay. Here's what bothers me about 20 years not having a job. There are people who are literally like you. I can't get a job because I'm a former felon. There are people who are literally illegal immigrants who make money every day doing a legal job, not drugs or anything else.
Right. Doing masonry.
You can't get a masonry job?
He couldn't use that degree to freelance someplace?
Anywhere.
You couldn't develop an LLC and just try to start something, yo? That battery bothered me.
That battery, though.
He could have legitimately started an LLC. You only need $300 to start an LLC. Start an LLC and then did freelance engineering.
Yeah.
Yep.
Consulting, anything. Once you have a business, you don't have to say, my business is run by a felon. It's just your business.
So, you know, one of the things about
I'm way too smart for this movie is what I realized.
Get yourself PE and an LLC and go into consulting. That's it.
Here's the thing.
You make bank.
You know, it's
Scott could have been your boss.
It's not our job to, you know, actually developed the movie for Tyler Perry, because this is all things that we just came up with like in the span of like 2-3 minutes, and they had a whole week.
Yeah, a whole week to think of. Right, exactly. In a week you think you would have figured out how that doesn't make any sense.
Like why 20 years? Why, like, no place hired him because he was a felon? Really? Okay.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense.
Not one? Not McDonald's? They take anybody.
So
UPS is hiring.
Always hiring.
So Diana, the woman that Robert was cheating on Melinda with 20 years ago, just serendipitously reappears, now working as the assistant to Prescott.
She's very pretty.
Yes, she is.
And she looks like little Rihanna.
Yeah, she looks like young Taraji P. Henson.
And they're like, and she's like, all right, eventually she is his in, and she's like, all right, I'll try to help you arrange a meeting with Prescott. The Melinda's family comes to Melinda and is like, this nigga needs a fucking job. So we are going to, you know, we have our own moving company or catering business or whatever. Straight to You Delivery. That's the name of their company.
Oh.
Straight to You Delivery. Because.
All right.
Matter of fact, right? Straight to You Delivery. So they're like, all right, look, he can work at Straight to You Delivery, our moving company. But yeah, because he needs a job, but we're going to be unpaid? Watching his ass.
But the sister was like, we also can't pay you.
Yeah, because they had to like. They had to go in debt a little bit for the trucks or something like that?
Yeah, and so I got the sentiment of that scene, but I was also like, but if you can't pay him, what is the point of this? Like, just so to he can have busy work?
You know what I think it was? They were like, we're tired of seeing this nigga freeload and sit around. Come to work so with us.
It took them 20 years for them to come to that conclusion?
Yes, because they're all dumb.
And then when you're like, he needs to be doing something, you're not, this is something that he can't even get paid for?
Again,
I think whatever money he was going to make was going to help wipe out the debt.
Okay. Yeah.
Oh, so they could, because remember the house is getting ready to be foreclosed on.
Oh yeah. Right.
So yeah, Taraji P. Henson looks. They made her look rough as fuck in this movie.
Yeah, I don't.
She looks crazy.
And I still
crazy.
Don't know why they gave her light blue contacts. That,
I don't
that
either.
Don't work.
But. So they apparently. There might have been a scene missing or something like that, but apparently Robert had a meeting with Diana, and Diana left her wallet in his truck.
Yeah, they cut that scene.
Yeah, because I don't remember those two meeting in a truck.
They said that they were getting a coffee together, and then the next thing you know is that she left his wallet.
Yeah, because she rode in his truck and. Because she doesn't have her own car, or there wasn't a coffee shop that was close to work.
Yeah, I don't know. It didn't make sense.
Nope.
So the eldest sister finds the wallet, and now we cut to Straight to You Delivery. The husband of the two sisters is like, all right, look, bro, we got a very important client. This client will make or break us, because in Tyler Perry world, there is only one thing. And that one thing is the one thing that will either help us or send us straight to hell. Right. And
his life is very binary in that way.
Right. That's you need to make this delivery, and you need to make it on time. Right. So he's like, all right, man, I got it. I'll make it a delivery on time.
Oh, okay. Right? Hold. So the dude who hasn't had a job in 20 years that you can't trust with any level of responsibility, give him the biggest contract.
The most important thing that is going to either sustain this business or completely tank it.
But to that fucking guy. Why? Just drive it yourself.
Because
shit
plot.
Don't make sense, man. God damn it. Makes no sense. And they're tracking him. So they obviously didn't think he could do the job. They're tracking him. He was like, hey, I see you going the opposite way. Call me back.
And he's not answering his phone.
He's not answering his phone because he got a call from Diana saying, look, Prescott wants to meet with you, but he has to meet with you in 15 minutes because if you don't come in 15 minutes, no matter where you are in the world, he's not going to be able to meet with you.
I really hate that in movies.
What the fuck is going on,
like,
man?
I really,
that level of logic is insane.
I really hate when movies and TV shows do that when you're clearly in the they do that with New York a lot. And they'll be like, we're all the way over here. And we need you to be here in 10 minutes. And then they leave the apartment, they get dressed and all this stuff like that. And then they make it in 10 minutes. I really don't
like
that.
Yeah, like, what the
I don't
fuck
like
is
that
going
trope.
On? So he's like, all right, I'll be there, you know, whenever Prescott, I'll do it. So he takes the delivery truck. He goes to his house to get his battery running on 20-year-old technology.
Right. And the box where it looks like it is.
Right. And he goes, the trash men are about to take it, but he grabs them and he is on his way. Right. And everybody's trying to contact him. He's like, what the fuck is going on, yo?
Wait, I think we missed the part where his battery blew out the electricity in the house. Did we pass that part already?
Yeah, we passed that part. That was part of like the money going down.
He's working, baby. Boom. We need $30,000 for new wiring all through the house. Like,
right.
You're not a very good engineer.
So he gets his battery, runs in the house, changes his clothes. Melinda comes in and was like, "Who the fuck is this bitch?" Like, and he's got her Diana's wallet. She's like, "You still fucking with this bitch?" And dude is like, "I don't have time to talk to you right now. I gotta go to Prescott. I gotta go to Prescott to deliver this my battery." And she's just like, "No, what the fuck is this? Like, take these keys, nigga.
Take them. I dare you to take them. Try and take them." Well, I'd have been like, "Give me the keys."
I'm right. I'm strong on them. Grab her hand and just take the keys.
I gotta go. Trying to make these millions. Get the fuck out of here.
So he's like, "Look, I need these keys, baby. I gotta go. I need the keys. I need the keys to my 20-year-old Mustang. Yeah. I need these keys."
Yeah.
And they
it has a new window, by the way, the one that you broke 20 years ago.
They get into a fight, right? Like she is on him, right? Like, she is fucked up.
I didn't like this because they made it out to be like he was hitting her, dude. That's kind of fucked up.
Yeah.
He is like towering over her.
He would have thrown her through that fucking front porch. Like,
and when the two sisters are trying to break it up, the eldest sister, who always had the problem with him, she hits him with his bag like, "Yeah, I'm going to get your ass." I'm like, "I'm going to break this up, but not before I get your ass."
Yeah, I had 20 years dealing with your shit. Yeah, it is really funny. It looks like they're just like straight up fist fighting in the front line. It's like, dude, he was just trying to get the keys to his shitty Mustang that he never paid for. His sister's like, "Nah, fuck you, nigga."
So,
she got Tim's on.
Robert runs to Prescott, right? And
15 minutes.
Yeah.
This is the longest 15 minutes in the world.
I'm sorry, but he would have walked into that meet and smelled like a fucking sub shop. Get out of here. They'd have never gave that nigga a dollar. Nah.
So he makes it. The guy was like, Hey, I don't know why you bought this fucking battery. We didn't need it. We got all your information because all the shit that you kept sending us for 20 years. And Diana sent us your information. I looked over your work. Looks great. We want to buy it outright for $800,000. And we bought this battery. You don't have any rights to it. You sign over the rights for $800,000.
Hold. You taking that $800,000?
In my situation,
this is a pivotal fucking question.
In my situation, I probably would not have the foresight to think further, right? Because I'm like, oh shit, like, this is why I'm not an athlete. Well, one of the many reasons why I'm not an athlete is why I need a lawyer present, because this invention, if this phantom magical invention, is worth a lot of money. But at the same time, I'm broke, yo.
And that's what they're counting on.
Yeah, because they want to own the rights.
That's exactly what they're counting on.
Because it's not just part of they want to own the rights to his research, which is what really gets him. So Jay, would you?
Oh, at that time? Look. Yeah, man. Give me that $800,000. And okay. I'm stunting on her ass when I get back. I want a divorce. And this is $800,000.
Really?
Fuck her, dude. Don't accuse me of cheating. I didn't cheat. Like, nah,
but you've had a history of cheating, though.
No, I don't have a history of cheating. I cheated once.
Okay, but
in history.
Yeah, like, that's not a history of cheating, is like every other month.
But here's the thing.
No, she'll get.
But here's the thing. Zero. But she finds the wallet of the woman that you cheated on her with.
Yeah, that's a mistake.
So why would you be like, "Oh, I'm not gonna give you anything"? And here's the thing. And she bankrolled you.
You know what I would do?
You can give it back that $350,000.
Nah,
not at all. He's bringing home $800,000.
Yeah, like, nah, yeah, that's cutting a little too deep into my pockets. Look, again, what he does later is he might as well have released a mythical dragon, because that shit makes no sense to me whatsoever.
Okay.
So at that time, I probably would have taken the $800,000. I literally yelled at the screen. I was like, "Nigga, take the money! Like, what the fuck?" But yeah, in hindsight, he's absolutely right.
Yeah, he was absolutely right. But if I was in his dire straits, I probably would have. Oh. But if I wasn't, like, if I just came up with this shit,
nah,
I wouldn't do it. But, you know.
Especially after 20 years, right, after 20 plus years of working on this, and only $800,000.
How about you start your own business with that $800,000? There's a thought.
Right. You could do that. Right? Yeah, you could bankroll it and be like, because you would think after 20 years of working on this battery, you had come up with other ideas. you know, of other engineering ideas.
I don't know, man. You come up with a phantom battery that can power its own self so that nobody, so that energy is just abundant now. Yeah, that takes a lot of brain power.
Yeah, I guess that is the only thing you really
think. You would think at 20, he would, his other ideas would probably be better than this, than his first one. But let's not like write the movie for Tyler Perry.
That's because, just like an engineer though, yo. Like engineers, they're like artists, man. They don't like, yeah, they come up with an idea.
That's it.
That's it. And don't you dare fucking criticize it.
Mm.
That's just how
you
they go, man.
You taking that $800,000? In these dire shirts.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think everybody would.
Yeah, I mean, so I understand later on when things get a little bit heated and he comes on with the news.
Yeah, yo, so he...
Yo, Taraji P. Henson in this one moment is 100% correct. That fucking dialogue is amazing.
So he comes home because he's...
I'm a loser.
He turns down the $800,000 and Diana was like, yo, what the fuck? Like, Prescott's not going to budge. And he was like, nah, I know this phantom battery that will cure everybody's energy problem. It will solve the energy crisis. It is worth more than $800,000. And he's like, I just can't do it. Just like, all right, I respect the hustle. So he goes home and everybody's sitting there and Taraji P. Henson is smoking a cigarette. And he's like, baby, I declined the offer because it's worth more than $800,000. And she's just like, nigga, fuck off.
Yo, she is ashing a cigarette inside a house. That's a level of disrespect I cannot abide. I'd be like, look, I know that this house is almost foreclosed on. I get that. But use an ashtray. All right.
But it's her house.
No, still, that's disrespectful.
It's her house.
Yeah.
Well, for the next week. She was like, it's like she got senioritis with that house. This is like, fuck it. Who cares? It ain't mine no more. It's the bank's. Fuck the bank.
That's her mama's house.
Well, not
her
anymore.
Family home.
It's M&T's house now. Mm-hmm. It's Bank of America's house now.
B of A. Just put a big old stamp right on the front of your door.
So she is, she's pissed. And this is the breaking point. She wants a divorce.
I'd be like, good. So, you seem crazy.
So she calls him a loser. And
that feels correct.
And I know, but like, well, I think by this point I'd already known what was going to happen. So, but I really felt that when she was like, "You're a loser. That's all you are. You ain't nothing. You are just a loser." And like his face,
that
was
shit
just
hurt.
Like, I was like, "Ah."
Look, if there's one thing that Taraji P. Henson, the person, can do, it is cut a nigga down.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. I ain't fucking with her, yo.
Yeah, she has a way of like. Her she has a sharp tongue. Like,
yeah, man.
She can deliver a line. And this one says she's better than
this
movie.
She's way better than this movie.
Way better than
this movie.
So, like, I mean, but, like, I mean, you guys are obviously men. But, like...
Thank you.
But, like, is it really that hurtful if a woman, like, looks at you and says, like, you are nothing. You are a loser.
No, yeah, that would
it
hurt.
Because men are dumb and they're full of, like, ego, right? And
very
and,
sensitive.
Yeah, snowflakes.
And we're all super sensitive. Cucks. I mean, you know, somebody, you'll get people who are like, that don't fuck me.
You're lying.
Yeah, right, no, lying. Lies.
You want to know why I started working out? Because somebody was like, because my dad once was like, "Hey, you're looking kind of fat." I was like, "Nah, fuck that, sensitive nigga." And I was like, "Nah, fuck all this." Yeah, men are sensitive too. Like, we just pretend, like, societally wise, that we just don't give a shit about stuff. Yes, we do.
Especially if it's something that you've been working on and you really wanted it to like go really big, and then she's like, "You know what? Fuck you. You ain't nothing. You're trash, and you're canceled."
Yeah.
And you
be like,
never,
what do these terms mean? It's 1996. I don't know.
You will never amount to anything. You are nothing.
Look,
I can't believe I spent the last 20 plus years with you and wasted my whole entire inheritance money on you.
Yeah, look, that shit would hurt. But like, here's the thing. In the same regard, you see any, you know, that whole adage of behind every successful man is a successful woman, right? Mm-hmm. Which I actually kind of disagree with. I think it's next to, right? Mm. But in that, like, when you have, speaking as a guy, if you have a wife or, you know, significant other who is supportive of you, you feel like you can do anything. And, like...
She was supportive.
Yeah, no, she was. And then he created this super battery. But then she ain't sticking out.
I mean,
because he's a loser.
Oh, okay, but
she
like,
just didn't stick it out long enough.
And okay, and we're gonna get to it. But would you? But would you have stuck it out that long?
Fuck no! I totally understand. No, yo, they're sticking it out, and then they're just being somebody's sponsor. Get out of here.
But you wouldn't give her any money if you took the $100,000, even though she stuck it out with you for 20 years. And you've been trifling this entire. She bought you a car. She took you back.
All right. $5,000 is pretty good. It's pretty good.
No, damn.
She made me take my Nina Simone records. She just threw that shit in the pile. That's disrespect. That's like $5,000 every record I just find on the floor.
You know what's also disrespectful? Not having a job for 20 years.
No, you're right. You're right. Look, he's wrong. Years.
And then blowing out the entire house's electrical circuit.
Yeah, I just called Demetrius. I'd be like, yo, come on. Yo, give me a black people hookup. Come on. Do it for $250.
So Melinda loses the house, moves in with her sister, and she begins to date her ex-boyfriend. We see that Robert has a job as a dishwasher.
Why couldn't you get that job fucking 19 years ago?
And he's living in the shelter. Like, this shit made me so mad. I'm like, really? It took this for you to go get a job as a fucking dishwasher?
Look, sometimes that's what they need. That's what the trifling nigga needs.
So we get a scene of everybody at the divorce hearing. And Robert is like, baby, I love you. I really don't want to do this. And the lawyer's like, nah, nigga, sign this shit. And
by the way, this is the story of my wife's first marriage.
Oh, really?
Hey. What?
This is the fucking whole thing. Minus like the last scene. Right? maybe I don't know. Like, she just survived.
Minus the crazy.
Yeah, my wife's not a nutbag, but like this scumbag nigga. Sure.
Oh, the whole I'm working on this life this world changing project.
Or selling T-shirts in Japan, whatever.
What?
He's begging and pleading to not get a divorce, and he's like, I love you, and please don't do this. And everybody else is just like, apparently Robert has no family, and everybody else is just like, nah, yo. And he was like, I didn't cheat on you, baby, and I'm really sorry, and if you want me to do this, then I'll do it.
I believed him.
And he signed the divorce
paper. He did love her. He didn't cheat on her.
Yeah, I believe he didn't cheat, and I believe he loved her, but... Yeah, I mean, but this whole 20 years too long.
Well, the sponsorship deal has gone on a little too long. But, yo, I'm not Nike. Get out of here.
It's hard for me, really, because one, I don't have $350 like that. And also, like I said, I'm not selfish, but I don't like spending money on other people. And 20 years, dog?
She was mad.
Yeah, I mean.
But then the lottery came in.
So the next act is called Sunder. We see that Diana is contacting Robert, saying that, hey, you know, Prescott wants to meet with you again. Well, no, she's saying, hey, you're living in a shelter? What the fuck? No, come stay with me. You're not living in a shelter. And he's broken, and at this point, she's putting him back together.
This whole movie is a fucking black Twitter fucking thread. It's a rage thread.
God.
We get a scene of Taraji P. Henson fucking this LeVar Ball Joe Budden. And he's like, man, Robert really knew how to fuck. This guy, he's a wham bam, thank you, man.
Well, hey,
Robert,
you know what?
Really knew how to push my buttons. Because
Robert wasn't doing anything else. Yes,
that's the job of a trophy spouse.
You're supposed to put in work. Yeah, you gotta put in work.
If you don't have a job, then you should at least know how to put it out.
So what are these strokes, by the way? He was just like, done.
It's like
my dog trying to scoot his butt on the sidewalk. Like, what are you doing?
Because that's the way that Tyler Perry views sex between heterosexual people.
Yeah, gross.
Yeah, he's like, and also,
how
like,
do you guys do this?
This is the first shot of a man's ass that we see.
There's a lot. There's a lot in this. Yeah.
It's just a man's ass, like.
But you know, equal opportunity, Tyler Perry.
Yeah, whatever.
I mean, he likes it. It's fine.
Yes, equal opportunity in that way, like in all of his movies, though.
Yeah. I bet not see no dicks in movies, though. That's different. That's gay.
That's dumb.
It is dumb.
Like,
what do I care?
Right. I mean, equal opportunity.
No, just show boobs. It's fine.
No, titties, yo. Yeah,
all day, every day. Titties, yo.
Men are just...
So, scumbags.
Yes.
So, anyway, let's move on. One, so...
No Robert, one wants to see penis anyway.
Robert and Diana. Sorry. Robert and Diana are like, she's building him back up and they are together now. Yeah. And Robert and Diana comes in with an offer from Prescott. Prescott reconsidered because Prescott is like, yo, this battery is really going to solve the world's energy crisis. Maybe we should get this guy on the hook because he might go somewhere else. Oh, wait. No, he won't.
No.
Because he's dumb. So Prescott is offered a multi-million dollar deal.
$75 million.
Yeah.
That is a very important fact that you should not forget.
Yes. $75 million and allows him to keep his IP for the technology.
Yo, you're fucking wildin'. You're wild. If he offered him $800,000 and allowed him to keep his IP, that's a deal.
Yeah.
Right.
That's a deal.
But right. I don't know where the 70... That thing must be changing the world.
This
because
is birdemic levels of throwing money around. Like, oh, I just created a... I closed the deal for $1 billion. And now driving around in my Mustang that is eco-friendly.
Like it's 500 miles to the gallon.
What the fuck?
So his very first deal after 20 years, he gets $75 million and gets to keep the IP. Okay.
Yeah. So now what? Your boy Robert shows up at your job.
With flowers.
With flowers.
In a nice suit.
Brand new Armani suit. Looking like Michael Avenatti.
Bastard.
He's out there, right? And he's like, look, I got a check for, again, I can't even say this.
She asked if he borrowed that suit.
First, yeah. she's like, look, we ain't getting back together. You know that, right? And she's like, yeah, I know. I understand. We're never getting back together. I'm glad you said it
because what comes next, you're going to be mighty mad about.
See?
I just wanted to tell you that I want to thank you for all the love and support that you gave me over 20 years. And I am forever in your debt. And I hope that this will help make it up. And here's the deed to your house. Put your house back, and here is a check for $10 million.
That should have been in the movie right there. The movie should have ended right here. Because to me, this is... Go ahead.
No, I'm sorry. I cut you off. Go ahead.
Because I feel like $10 million... I mean, he's... that's a pretty good...
Nigga, $10 million, yo.
This is the part where I go, whatever happens after this... is fucking stupid.
Because yes.
What should have happened is she should have taken her shoes off, did the fucking moonwalk around that office, put it in her boss's face and said, I fucking quit, and then walked off into the sunset.
She should just been like, you know what? You're right. You do owe me $10 million for everything I did for you. And then she should
thanks,
be like,
nigga.
You should like, good luck. I'm set for life. And
I'm going to go back to fucking this whack ass dude.
Yeah. And roll credits. That's it. That should have been it. But
Tyler Perry's like, no, we have one more day of shooting.
Golly,
I know it's day 7. We have one more.
What do we have? An extra, 30 minutes on this movie?
37 more minutes left.
Ooh, boy. The next chapter is... Yes, and that is the definition, to express great regret.
I don't like that we have to get all these definitions for each chapter.
It's because Tyler Perry got one of those, like, word of the month things, and he was like, acrimony! I'm going to do a movie about this.
Yo, what if that was, like...
You think it's not? You really think it's not? Look. You know what? Let me look and see if I can find.
So
go ahead.
So Melinda comes home to the family, and they sitting around playing spades or whatever. And Melinda comes in, and she's mad, right? Because she's like, "Huh? Saw Robert today." And like, oh yeah, what that dumb nigga doing?
And then we balling, dog.
Right. Then she throws down the check for $10 million.
Like she threw down, and then she walked away. I was like, "Girl, but." You didn't cash it, girl. Pick that shit up.
Yeah, you better have done a digital.
And here's the thing:
this is a digital deposit.
This is 2016, so we all know she has mobile deposit on her phone. So almost maybe she did that. So did she keep the money?
Yeah, she kept that money.
I mean, did she like deposit it? Because
look, her sister told her to do it. She was like, "This shit probably ain't even real." And Melinda was like, "I called. It's real." And they're like, well, why didn't you cash it then? Like, what the fuck? Like, cash this shit and let's go.
Before this nigga changes his mind.
Right, let's go to Red Lobster. Like, what the
hell? We can go buy a Red Lobster. That's unlimited cheddar biscuits.
And she's... And
she, I'm just saying, that's a good idea.
Is that they go to a nice restaurant with black people?
Apparently.
That didn't go to Corral? So just...
Yeah, this, no, Golden Corral cannot this, be on that list. That's unacceptable.
I work across from a Golden Corral. Ugh. And this woman every day comes and will go to Corral for lunch. She goes every day.
For lunch?
Yes. And I'm working near Rundle Mills. Mm. So... out of all like the food places there, she goes to Golden Corral.
She black?
Yeah.
Nah. Your level of cholesterol is going to be too high. You're going to die.
So the family is like, oh, all right, well, cash it, girl. And Melinda's like, no, I shouldn't have listened to you motherfuckers. See, all y'all said that he wasn't going to mount the shit. And for 20 years, while he wasn't a mountain of shit, all I had to do was just keep waiting.
Her sister was like, shut the fuck up. Yeah, you can't do that. Look, don't do that internet thing where something happens and then you act like you always knew.
Right.
Yeah. Come on, yo. No, you thought this broke nigga was going to be broke forever.
And the brother-in-laws were like, yeah, I always liked Robbie. He was always... I was like, all right.
I always knew he was going to do it.
Yeah, y'all just want his money. That's it.
God damn. She was like, Devin, you should go home and never call me again. You're horrible in bed. Guy from Key and Peele, get out of here. You are too big to have such a little dick. God damn.
All right, look. She ain't had to say all that.
I mean, look, she a millionaire. You say, look, if I suddenly had a check for $10 million, I'd tell each and every one of y'all about yourself.
That is literally the definition of fuck you money.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Just, you know, let us know when you do make $10 million. Let us know.
No. I'm going to talk shit first.
You going to know.
I'm going to talk shit first from my limo with bulletproof windows. Y'all ain't shit. You too, Terrence.
Just drive the fuck on and never hear from me again.
I'm just going to say it came from the Russians.
Yeah, that's fine. I'd launder their money.
So, not above it. We cut to the penthouse apartment that Robert said that he was always going to have, right?
It's his baller.
And it's really nice. And he's in a tuxedo looking like
new money.
Black James Bond.
Looking like Boss Kananga from that Black James Bond movie.
Yeah, he does. Yeah.
He's a Jamaican.
By the way, I said this to my wife when we were watching this. We need more actors that look like this guy.
Yeah.
He's a handsome, dark-skinned black dude. Like,
he's Jamaican. Jamaican-Canadian.
Yeah, his name is Lyric with a Q. Of course he's foreign. Of course he's Jamaican.
He does look good in that suit.
Yeah, he's like a handsome guy. Like, and we need more people that just look like that.
We need more people
in tailored suits, period.
Yes, I'm tired of everybody dressing in fucking basketball shorts and wife beaters. Like, all right. I'm old, man.
Like, yeah, I'm like, yo, that's some old ass shit that you just said.
I know. I look. It is what it is.
Put
your pants up.
So this is the part of the movie where I started to be like, yeah, okay, but Robert isn't really in the wrong here for the rest of the film.
I think that was the point,
right? He ain't wrong at all. The second his ass wrote a check that said $10 million on it, he was in the
right. That should have been the end of the film.
And look, he gave her $10 million. That will be something that I bring up quite often in the next few minutes, because her actions are not that of a person who has $10 million in the bank.
They don't think pieces about this movie?
I don't know.
Oh. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm not a kid. So,
she's so crazy.
Taraji P. Henson goes up to the penthouse, and Robert opens the door looking, you know, all suave and shit, and Taraji P. Henson's like, oh my god, look at this is so beautiful. I always knew you was gonna do it, Robert. I always knew you said you was gonna do it, and you did it. Look at what we got.
he's like, like the royal we?
Like we as in like French? Like yes.
I'm going to Paris this weekend.
Like we as in, yeah, look at what I have.
Wee wee.
And Taraji's, she just got her drawers on. She got a trench coat and drawers on, and she's like,
look,
yeah.
Look.
I'd be like, trust me, I'm looking.
Look, I'd be like, are you, I mean, I'm very rich right now. Are you okay with me, you, and my new friend here? Because I feel like I'm rich enough to make that happen.
So, I mean, yeah, actually, he's rich enough to be.
I feel like he can make that happen.
$75 million Yeah,
yeah, yeah, I feel like he'd make that happen.
He can make that happen. But he's a good guy. He's always been a good guy. And so she, you know, you see that she's wearing some lacy drawers, and all of a sudden, Diana, Robert's fiance, comes out and she's like, "Oh, excuse me. Hey, how you doing?" And
let's put your underwear on.
And she was like, and Taraji P. Henson looks at her like, "What the fuck? Like, huh?" Like, and this woman is statuesque and is dressed in like this dress to the nines and shit. And this is the fucked up thing. First of all, you don't shake somebody's hand with your left hand, right? But she extends her left hand,
yeah,
and she extends that shit like this.
Yeah.
Bam! Look at that. And then just like, how you doing?
Yeah.
Like, oh, you bitch.
Yeah, it was fucked up.
But she just wanted to see that big ass rock. Meanwhile, you know, the ghost of that ring pop that she had on her hand was still there. You know what I mean? Diana literally has everything that Robert promised to Melinda, had Melinda not wanted a divorce. Don't forget that, folks.
I mean, yeah,
she wanted that divorce.
But
you wanted this.
But here's the thing. If you were her, would you have asked for a divorce? If your significant other turned down $800,000 and your house is about to be foreclosed on, and you guys are broke.
Yeah. No, I would have. No. After 20 years of nonsense, that's the straw that broke the camel's back.
No, that was a valid. I mean, she was totally valid. Yeah. Where she wasn't valid is thinking she could roll right back in after getting a $10 million check. Like, right. That was. I felt a little gold diggerish to me. Like, yeah, it just did.
It doesn't make sense.
Like, you hated this guy yesterday to, you know.
But he achieved his dream.
Yeah.
And money means something to everybody.
I mean, it does.
So, was she completely wrong for trying to?
Yeah, you were, man. You got $10 million.
She wasn't completely wrong. She's completely wrong when she's in the car doing voiceover like, that shit was mine.
Yeah, okay.
No, it wasn't.
Yeah.
And I bet he's fucking her in the shower just like he fucked me in the shower because he knows how to do it.
And then we see his ass again. I'm like, okay, Tyler, we get it.
More man, but look, it is what it is, man. And she's like, this is where she's fucking losing it. And shit,
yeah.
Right? Like, now she's in the wrong. And she's like, oh, I bet you he's whispering sweet nothings into her ear while he's fucking in the shower in that big ass house that's supposed to be mine. And I bet he's all hugged up on her and shit. Meanwhile, I got this limp dick nigga, bald head ass motherfucker, and I just don't like it. And this is mine. She that bitch stole my life. And then
Raul was having a good ass time after he got paid.
And then,
if I suddenly was worth $70 or $65 million,
that boat gale force winds.
Hey, we on the boat, girl. Yeah, we got a boat. We rich.
We cut to,
we don't owe nobody nothing.
She Facebook stalking and Instagram stalking. And
we cut to the next chapter, entitled Deranged. Melinda becomes obsessed with the couple. And continues a campaign of revenge and
via social media.
Mutilates photos she has of them.
And does witch doctor dances to Nina Simone.
Which is weird.
Like, the whole scene was like in red or whatever.
Yeah, it was odd. I'm like, don't disrespect Nina Simone with your shenanigans.
Lack of sleeping and eating further pushes her closer to the edge. Melinda ends up suing Robert and Diana, claiming that the deal with Prescott happened before their divorce. It did not. It happened after the divorce. And the case is dismissed.
You know, the judge was like, he gave your ass $10
million. Which is more generous than any other person would have been.
Yeah, the judge was like, bitch, what the fuck is your problem?
But he also bought her house back.
Yeah. And so, besides that, he gave her $10 million. Fuck that goddamn house.
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
I don't know what else you want from him.
She wants the entire 75 million.
She wants that boat. She wants to fuck him in the shower. She wants the man that she fell in love with.
Oh, he gone
20 plus the money. Years ago. And the money, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Plus the money. The 75 million is what she wants.
She wants the rich nigga that she fell in love with.
Yeah.
Not the poor broke nigga.
Not the broke nigga.
You know what she did? She fell in love with potential.
That is a mistake.
It's a dangerous game you play.
Don't do it.
My wife says that shit all the time. Like,
you are with the person that you with.
That's right.
And then, because you know, then your crazy will be dormant for 20 years, and then next thing you know,
you want a boat in the middle of a
of a tank.
Yeah, in the middle of a Tyler Perry Studios, acting like a goddamn fool with a natural blowout.
This is the same crazy place where Black Panther was.
Yo,
filmed.
This chick is on Facebook. When the case is dismissed, she's on Facebook Live. Yo,
I'm gonna kill this nigga.
Talking about why he do this to me and this, that, and they stole from me. Like, all right.
As she gets into her $10 million car and drives off.
This is where, like, it was around this part where I was just like, I don't even like this film. I wasn't even having a good time watching it.
This shit was just, I was just like, yo, it's just kind of dumb, yo. It's just kind of dumb.
I did enjoy Joe's girlfriend from the Flash being on there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Joe's new baby mama. She's really attractive.
She is super cute.
She is. I didn't realize that she's in her mid-40s. I thought she was like 30.
Oh, I did.
And she is super short.
Her and Candace Patton
feel like
they'd be
a
sisters.
Real heighted person. Yeah.
Wow. So Melinda's sisters and her cousin go out to check on her. They find a bunch of photos of the couple. Robin and Diana file a countersuit against Melinda for her threats and obtain restraining orders. Melinda's family has to restrain her from going after Robin and Diana as they leave the courtroom. Melinda goes to a... So
this shit is insane.
Melinda eventually, like, they have a meeting. Everybody but Melinda has a meeting, and Melinda comes and she's like, yo, what the fuck? All of you betrayed me. Like,
isn't Robert there?
Robert. Literally, and the whole cast is there. And they was like, you betrayed me. And she goes to a bridal shop and destroys Diana's wedding gown with hydrochloric acid that she just picked up from the giant.
She has $10 million. She could probably make that happen.
Again, she has $10 million. Why are you worried about these people?
Yeah.
Because she could have had $75 million.
See, money will fuck your shit all the way up.
Well, you know.
Can you imagine being upset that you didn't have $75 million when you had $10 million?
And that's the thing, right? Like, she's crazy. Like, yeah. The money is not the issue.
She probably didn't even cash that check.
No.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I don't think she ever did anything with that money.
No,
she left it on that table with her sisters and brother-in-law. And I'm like,
yo, they cashed that shit. They're like, yo, this business is booming.
Yo, we about to go straight to deliver this check to the bank. Fuck that. Yeah, she's crazy. Yeah. And I think that's like the point.
Yeah.
So after committing this act of vandalism, she is caught. And back at the courtroom, she's given a stern talking to, which loops us back to the beginning of the movie, right? We find out that Diana is pregnant, and that sets Melinda off.
Ouch.
She's like, yo, what the fuck? I can't have babies because you were fucking, I caught you fucking that bitch 20 years ago and now you having her baby? What the fuck, yo?
Yeah, that sucks.
Yeah, it does suck.
At that point, I was like, yeah. I was like, okay, all right, I guess I can understand it. I get it.
I mean, I get being mad, but I also get having $10 million.
Yeah, like that, like the entire title, so I can think of, like, yeah, I would be mad, but I wouldn't be $10 million, man.
I mean, like, well, for $10 million, you know, the world is suddenly a better place. There are no issues in the world.
No, just go on vacation, my nigga. Like, just go to an island. Forever. Like, just go. I don't know.
So
just drink tropical drinks and just chill.
the therapy session, we're back to the therapy session, and the therapist says, girl, you crazy. You got you got borderline personality disorder, which is, I'm always a little leery when movies use like real illnesses like this, when the villains have these illnesses,
right?
Because it could be argued that this is how the filmmaker sees people with this disability. It's not something that you should just throw around. You know what I mean? Like, I know we all having fun ripping this movie apart, but that's some serious shit, man.
Yeah.
It's dangerous.
And you know, you know Tyler Perry didn't have any real consultants on his film.
No, of course not.
Because he wrote it in a week.
Right. So he's just like, she's fucking, she's fucking crazy. So she's got personality disorder. Like, like, you can't. Don't use real medical terms for your your villains.
Tell her she suffers from
being a stage five flinger.
Yeah, or like
that shit ain't real,
isn't it? It's on Wikipedia. It's got a link. No, I would just say she suffers from acute acrimony disorder.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. Because whatever. On Robert's wedding day, her family and friends guard the exits of her house. They block Melinda's car so that she can't go after them.
Yo.
So all of her personalities can't get out.
Apparently.
I'm not doing that for my family member, yo. You just want to be crazy on your own.
You just going to let your family member try to kill somebody on a boat? Spoiler alert.
You can't do that, yo.
You got to keep them locked up.
You got to keep them locked up because you don't want your family member to go to jail. Do you?
She like, which one? I don't like that one.
It depends on whether or not she cashed that $10 million check.
Yeah, I mean, that's
yeah, that check's still around, yeah.
I'm going to need you to just endorse this so I can fucking sell it.
The final chapter, inexorable, meaning unforgiving, relentless, unbending, inflexible, unyielding, merciless, pitiless, begins. And we see Robert and his wife and a whole crew of people on this yacht, an entire crew of people on this yacht. Don't forget that. They're on their honeymoon cruise and Melinda appears out of fucking nowhere. They are literally
brand new hairstyle and everything.
They are on a boat in the middle of whatever shitty river runs through Pittsburgh. And she comes in dry as a bone after having gone to get her hair done, you said.
Yeah.
And
she had like a little blowout.
It's longer. It's like it's longer.
Yeah, it's crochet.
She put in some crochet braids.
I was gonna say, did she add like some weave in before getting on the boat? She was like, I want to look luxurious before I fuck this
And have to dress in all white because
I'm dressed in a wedding gown.
Oh yeah.
Has Robert at gunpoint and he was just like, how the fuck you get on this boat?
And everyone reading the script also wondered the same thing.
How did you get on the boat and avoid detection from the 18 crew members that we have on this yacht?
And also, she's like, didn't Captain I give America. You $10 million?
Yeah, right. maybe she used that $10 million to buy a cigarette boat to speed up right next to this boat. And that's how she got there.
And she's got Robert at gunpoint and, you know, she's making like idle threats and shit. And, I don't know if it was by accident or whatever, but she shoots him in the gut while talking to him.
And she did look good, though.
And the crewman, she did.
She looked good crazy. They say the crazy one.
She still has those contacts, but okay.
And the crew come up and he's like,
I gave you $10 million. What the fuck are you talking about?
Like,
the crew members come up and be like, yo, we just heard a gunshot. What the fuck is going on? And she's like, she's got the gun and she's like, I want everybody to jump off this boat. And all these cowards, not one crew member, not one was like,
yo,
maybe we could take her. And they're like, nah. Which goes to show you that Robert ain't paying these motherfuckers nothing.
Yo, fight for me, dog.
But wouldn't you, if you have $75 million, wouldn't you want to pay for at least security?
You would think,
you wouldn't think you would need it. Like, he wouldn't think of that, right?
This
is
a GTA 5.
He's on a boat. Like, he's like, how the fuck is she going to get on this boat?
I don't know. How does she get hydrochloric acid to then, destroy the wedding dress? I feel like anyone who would be willing to do that, maybe you want to take some extra precautions.
So, she's got
I'd have spent the money to have her killed.
She's got the
gun. Wow. Right?
She's got
the gun. I have $65 million. I can afford it.
She's got the gun. She makes everybody jump off. Diana comes up and is like, oh, shit. And she turns right the fuck back around, and Melinda gives chase. Melinda corners her, and Melinda's like, give me that ring. That's my ring.
I thought she was going to shoot the pregnant woman. I was like, that's fucked up. Shoot the
pregnant woman, too. Robert comes in after, you know, keep in mind, he's been shot in the gut, right? Like, where the most vital of organs tend to be in your torso, and he got shot in the gut. He is limping his ass down, and he shoulder checks her off of the boat. Now, you see her get in the water. Mm-hmm. She gets in the water, and she's going away.
But you can tell that the water's not deep, because she's just like right at the top.
Right, because she's just right on the top of the water.
It's the kiddie pool that goes around like Adventureland, that you're like, you're sitting in the little rafts, and it's only going like a mile an hour.
So Robert is like, Diana, I need you to go hop on the dinghy and go get the rest of the crew members, and she's gone. Is it? But bring the people back, right? And all of a sudden, like fucking Jason Voorhees, Melinda just gets up on the boat again. She just climbs up on the boat. Apparently, that boat is not going fast because she just swam her ass back to it, I guess.
Yep.
And she's giving chase, right? She's chasing Robert. She grabs an axe. And she picks up an axe and look, I've held an axe before. It's not that heavy.
But wasn't she? She was like leaning and she was dragging.
She picks up that axe and is like, whoa! Like it's a goddamn sledgehammer, right? And she's stalking him and talking to him and shit, right? Mm. And I think he like trips and falls or some shit like
she's
that.
She's barely wet getting back onto the boat.
Yeah, she's completely fucking dry, right? So he
put a little bit on the train of the dress.
He falls down. He falls down. And she is standing there. She fucking chops his his foot, right?
Yeah.
Jesus.
And
Christ.
His reaction, you know, he flails around. He accidentally hits a button that drops anchor. The chain, the slack, the anchor drops, and the slack from the chain wraps around her foot and takes her over overboard.
Yeah.
And she's stuck, right? And she goes overboard and she drowns there.
Yeah, good. And they kept on telegraphing that was going to happen because they kept on like showing shots of her dress, of the train of her dress. I'm like, okay, guys, I guess we get it.
Yeah, we get it. So, and then we get lingering shots of her dead body in the water. And I guess this is supposed to be a good looking shot. I don't think it is. These scenes.
You can tell
this is
a dummy that fell in the water, too.
these scenes are where my wife was like, this water looks real fake.
Yeah, no kidding.
So, yeah, drowns to death. And that's the end of the movie.
Does he survive, you think?
We don't know. Even Wikipedia is like, he is very close to death.
I like to think he survived and then made another $75 million. Had a kid with that woman. They lived happily ever after. And she died at the bottom of what I assume is a creek. and she got nothing out of it.
Yo,
and
this movie,
he hired her brother-in-law and his sister, to deliver his food to his fancy building every day where they have to watch him as he looks down upon them because they look down on him all those years.
I would do that.
Oh,
I would do that.
Hell yeah. Fuck yeah. Every day. They'd be like, oh, you want us to deliver? I'd be like, you deliver it right there. Just throw it in the dumpster.
Yep.
So, that's how much money I got. Remember when y'all were laughing at me for 20 years?
So,
yes.
So petty. Yeah. Wow.
I have the money to be 100%. Petty.
Wow.
Yes.
Yeah, so...
So this movie stinks. it received if you care, it received a 21% on Rotten Tomatoes from critics,
way too high,
and a 49% average audience score.
Of course.
It's just a mess. It's a mess of storytelling. Like you could tell this was done, on a weekend, you know what I mean? Like mm-hmm. it just wasn't good.
Everybody
do you think
bored?
You could write? You think you could write a better story in a weekend?
In a weekend?
Yeah, uninterrupted.
You think the two of us could sit in a room and write a better story in a weekend?
Yes. Yeah. The two of us could, yes.
I think so.
Because you need ideas to bounce people off of. That's why the best movies have two writers.
Yeah. And, it's certainly true.
And, I mean, it just...
I kind of want to make a movie because I think we could do better than this.
This is...
I really do. I am not even kidding. I think we could do a better job than
this. This is bad, man. This is bad. And it speaks to how Tyler Perry sees women, even if it's on like a subconscious level. Like he would probably say, oh, well, I'm just, you know, just telling the story. It's not meant to be.
Yes, it's like he said that every black person has a Medea.
Yeah, yeah.
No, they don't.
You know, it just... And look, I don't mind black people doing like weird stuff, like different mm-hmm. stuff, you know, but like this is
no,
obviously,
sorry to bother you.
This is obviously a black version of Fatal Attraction, but it just doesn't quite like this idea is very good, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If he had time to actually develop it mm-hmm. or, you know, really think about it, like mm-hmm. I think this could have been something of better quality.
Mm-hmm.
Like it, you don't even, the germ of an idea is here, but when you half-ass it, like you're half-assing it.
Yeah, the whole thing.
Yeah. And
you're
and
not even going on location to get an outdoor shot. Like really, right. Yo?
You couldn't have gone to California or somewhere off the East Coast to do the last scene.
Right. And I just,
it seems weird.
It just seems, it's lazy. And that's the big thing that I don't like about some of his most of his movies mm-hmm. is that they're lazy, man. Like, don't be lazy. You are literally one of the top black directors. You can afford to not be this lazy.
Right. Yeah. And I thought the build up to them growing older 20 years took way too long.
Yeah,
I mean,
40 minutes.
Yeah,
I told you. I thought Taraji P. Henson was only in voiceovers.
2 hours. 2 hours.
Almost exactly.
Yeah. So the car could have cut a lot of that, and then spent more time on their marriage as a adults.
Yeah, you could have cut the flashback to 15 to 20 minutes.
Yeah, because you know, because it seems so. Well, it is so like just fast how he goes from meeting Diana again, and then all of a sudden, oh, he gets a $800,000 offer. Then what? A week later, he gets $75 million? Really?
Yeah, that's not even close.
I'm like, okay. Maybe I could have seen if it was like maybe $20 million, but almost $100 million?
Right. That $800,000 seems mighty insulting at this point.
Listen.
Yeah.
Yeah, this movie sucks. Fuck this movie forever.
Yeah. Any other parting words?
After Taraji P. Henson can do better.
Yeah. No more Proud Mary.
She has done better.
Yeah, exactly. She has done better.
So,
yeah, Proud Mary was not an example of that.
Yeah, don't not please. And that came out like a month before this.
Oh, yeah. This
or two months before this.
Yeah, 2018 was not her year.
So more Hidden Figures, like quality like films.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be super serious. She can have fun with movies. But,
right.
And look, again, like Micah said, you can even do a Fatal Attraction sort of movie, but you got to...
Not
tease it out a little bit. This,
you gotta
this,
give a shit, man. Like yeah, it just, this didn't felt care. Like it didn't give a shit.
Right.
Yeah, we got Taraji P. Henson and Lyric Bent. We can make this happen.
It's Tyler Perry film, so people are gonna go see it anyway.
I wonder if a lot of this was improv. Like he gave just general direction and was just like, this is go.
Maybe, because the Melinda character is very much like Cookie from Empire, from what I remember.
Yeah. I mean, seemingly.
I mean, Cookie was crazy, but not like not
I mean,
like
he probably
this.
He probably told her that Cookie is the attitude you should have, but like yeah. All rated.
And but here and also like I don't want Taraji to always do Cookie type roles. Like
yeah,
the same,
no,
like,
I really don't want to see her as just a mean, angry black woman.
Yeah. I don't want to see any more like baby boy. No, Primary wasn't like this, but Acrimony type roles.
You don't want to see Taraji P. Henson be fucked to sleep when she's like acting angry. Because that's what happened in that movie.
You mean after she gets backhanded?
Yeah.
Or something like that?
Yeah. Oh, why are you all mad? All right, let me just fuck you to sleep. Just calm down. Wow. Like, that was a real thing that happened.
Yeah.
All right, that is it for us for episode 134, Acrimony. It was a hell of a ride.
Yeah. Was,
so, yep. We'll see you next year for another Tyler Perry episode.
We might have to take next year off. We did two of them.
It's true. You know what?
Maybe I should just do a good Tyler Perry film.
We did it.
Yeah, we did.
Y'all haven't done Why Did I Get Married too?
We did the first one.
Is that good?
It's a movie. The Rock is in it.
He's in it for 13 seconds. No one can tell that lie.
He courts a black woman.
He did. He shook a black woman's hand once. And yeah, and looked no, like, no, he didn't. It was Janet Jackson. She won't try to be black either.
Or the y'all did The Family That Prays.
Yeah, that was a piece of garbage.
Yeah, that's not good, yo.
That did have a good backhand in it, though.
Of course. That's the part that you like.
He backhanded the shit out of the right counter. Come
y'all
on,
did Diary of a Mad Black Woman.
That's not good.
That's not good. Yeah.
Did y'all do Madea's Family Reunion?
We're not doing Madea movies. No. We said we'll do Tyler Perry movies as long as they don't have Madea as a star.
Daddy's Little Girls with Idris Elba?
We have not done that.
And the chick from Black Lightning?
No, we haven't done that, and we haven't done For Color Girls.
And we're not. We're not.
Going Wait, yo. I thought y'all did For Color Girls.
No, we talk about For Color Girls all the time because
they throw people out of throw kids out of windows.
What's his name? Throws his kid out of a
Mike
window.
Mike Bealy.
And on one episode, as a stinger, we had Janet Jackson and was talking to this one dude, and he was like, and she was like, "So you're gay?" And he was like, "I ain't gay. I ain't gay. Holding a man's hand, that's gay. I'm a man that enjoys having sex with other men."
Yo, that's
gay.
That's kind of the definition.
I don't think it gets much gay in that.
I think he was saying that he doesn't get fucked in the ass. He does the fucking. So that makes him straight.
Like, I don't do the bend. I don't get bent. I do the bending.
Like that's still pretty gay.
No, that's right up there with the having the sex with another dude.
I think that's all included in that package, buddy.
Yeah. Well, there you go. All right. That's it, 134 for Acrimony, and we will see you guys next week with another preview episode.
See you.
Bye.
Yeah. Bye. Yeah.